Varmt välkommen till Stora aktiedagen i Stockholm. Mitt namn är Lars Håkansson och jag är moderator idag för er. Och jag vill säga varmt välkommen till Klaus Olesen, CEO för Initiator Pharma. Och du kommer att presentera på engelska, Klaus.
So Thank you very much, Lars.
The show is yours, Klaus.
Yes. I will keep speaking English because my apprentice is a boss svenska yet. So welcome and good morning to all the people out there in the audience. So I would like today to present Initiator Pharma and some of the recent things that we have ongoing and what we look on for in the future. So just briefly, we are a clinical stage biotech company. We have two phase two clinical assets. So we actually have a pipeline of two molecules, two independent molecules, one in phase two and one has completed a phase 2A, and I'll get back to this soon. We are listed on the Spotlight Stock Exchange and we have a roughly 3,600 shareholders. And we have a seasoned management running the team, and also in the board we have a seasoned personnel there of industry veterans within the pharmaceutical industry. So we have a clinical pipeline of really strong IP on multiple assets. And also, as I said before, we have just recently completed a phase 2A proof of concept in organic erectile dysfunction, and we have an ongoing trial in what we call psychogenic erectile dysfunction. So Initiator Pharma is dedicated to developing novel and new treatments with significant unmet medical needs. And there's multiple ways of doing this, but today I'll present two of our programs. But before we get to that, I would like to draw your attention to a recent deal that we published earlier in the week or last week, where we actually secured financing for the clinical trial of the 2015 compound, the phase 2B trial that we have spoken about before. And actually, we struck a really, really nice agreement here. So MEC, the UK's largest independent clinical development organization that we worked with before on 2015, have actually chosen to get involved into this project. And it is a really unique opportunity for us because it's not only that they will run the study, but they will also take on the financing of the study. And what they can do at the end, they have the right to convert into shares at a premium of about 70% to the current stock price. So they will convert in at 7.50 Swedish crowns. If they choose not to convert, it's a three-year loan with a 1% interest per year. And I think this is just demonstrating again how we actually, with our compound 2015, have something that's very interesting. So the people that have worked with this compound over the last year and a half, 2 years, actually are willing to stick their neck out and invest in the company on equal terms, you can say, as the rest of the shareholders, however, paying a premium price for getting into this company. And we think this is very unique, and we think that this is actually a very unique deal. And we heard a lot from a lot of our clients around and collaborators around the world that they see this very attractive, that we actually can bring in a CRO to invest in Initiator Pharma. So I think that before we go into that, of course, we have an ongoing exercise of warrants. The TO2 warrants is running until the 15th of December. The strike price is $4.90. And the money that we are getting in from this exercise, the warrant program, is going to complete the financing of the clinical trial for IPET 2018. So I'll get back to this drug. And also, it will cover the business development course that is ongoing for 2015. So it's really important that we get the warrants in so we actually have the freedom to complete the trial. And remember, we have this loan facility from the former NOR at the end if we don't get this converted. But we would actually really much like to see the full money getting in from this. So just as I briefly mentioned, we have a clinical pipeline. We have IPET 2015 and 2018, and those are the two compounds I'm going to talk about today. And then we also have two other assets for depression and neuropathic pain. So we are looking to develop the proprietary CNS-acting molecules for a range of indications and medical conditions. So erectile dysfunction, I presented this many times before, but just a brief update. It's one of the most common male health disorders, sexual disorders. We know it impacts both the life of the patient and also very much the partner of the patient. We know that more than 320 million men will suffer from ED by 2025. This number is most likely highly underestimated, so much higher than that. Of course, we know there's a generic inflow of PDE5 and inhibitors, Viagra, Levitra, Cialis. But the positioning of what we are doing is very different to this. And this is also what is stated in the last bullet here, that there is a very big market here for new treatments coming in that addresses problems that are not currently solved with the current molecules in the clinic. So we know from previous studies that about 30 to 40% of all ED patients do not respond to the current treatment. And these are exactly the population that we want to target. We want to target the ones that don't get relief from Viagra, Cialis, or the combination of such compounds. So we will not be in competition with any existing thing out in the market. We'll be have a unique market for ourselves. So we know that this on response is a high on medical need, and this is what we are addressing in Initiator Pharma. So just on brief on the 2015 program, again, it's treating organic erectile dysfunction. So this is what happens when we get older. The system just get weaker through the response. And we see a gradual onset of this coming. And we start also seeing what we call lack of morning erections. So this is what happens to majority of the people that coming in, simply that lifestyle and age is playing into the role. 2015 is the solution for this. 2015 is a monoamine reuptake inhibitor, a triple monoamine with a preference for dopamine. So it inhibits the dopamine transporter in the neuron. So it actually thereby increases the concentration of dopamine out in the synaptic cleft and the downstream signaling. So what is that doing? Well, we know an erection is driven by stimulation, seeing something nice, being touched. All this is processed to a release of dopamine into this cleft. And when you then inhibit the reuptake transporter, you actually get a much stronger signal. So what we actually are doing here is that we are strengthening the natural erection response, simply just saying that, okay, when you see a signal, we make it even stronger. This leads to a series of events that increases the blood flow to the penile tissue, and we have the erection. So again, we are strengthening the natural erection response, and this is very unique for our compound. We recently completed a phase 2A study where we took in patients. We took in 12 patients and we did crossover with a placebo and active compound. And we looked at with the Retiscan where we could measure erections and stiffness of the penis. And here we actually saw that in 25% of these patients that are what we included are moderate to severe ED patients, so very hard to treat patients, we actually saw a response of 25%. This is very unique, actually, to take some of these patients that do normally not respond. And for the first time, we actually shown that with our compound, our technology, we can actually start inducing an erection response upon visual stimulation. Of course, this is, you know, you can say, is this translatable, what happened home in the bedroom or at home in the private area? Well, of course, the way to translate it, if you do not have an erection stiff enough for penetrating, you cannot have an intercourse. So this is actually the first signal showing that it also will work in the later setting. So with the MAC deal, we can actually now embark on a very unique thing. We can do a phase 2B intercourse study. So instead of having this visual stimulation where we actually showed an erotic movie to the patients in the clinic in a small confined room, which can be very stressful, we actually now sending the compound home to the patient and they can use it together with their partner. This is going to mean more than just, you can say, this is now we're looking at a real intercourse endpoints, will be the IFR3 scores and the sexual encounter scores, which we also will be using eventually with a partner or a larger pharma will use in a phase 3 setting. But these are the true endpoints that we'll be looking at here. Also, we believe that when sending home the compound to the partner, using it at home together with them, we'll actually take away a lot of the stress and anxiety connected to doing the, you know, can say the visual stimulation that is ongoing in the clinic. So we take away the erotic movie, we take away the male nurses and also the mounting of the Retiscan onto the penis. So we make, you can say, a more trusty environment where we actually believe that the patient will respond much stronger to the treatment. And this is very unique, and we look forward to embarking on this phase 2 trial. So we are working on submitting the CTA application for this during the first half of 21, and then get started as soon as possible with MAC as a really strong partner in this. So now not only are they going to run the trial, but they also have an incentive for completing a trial on time and also making sure that we get the right patients into this. So this is very strong. We haven't finalized the design completely yet. This is something we just need to discuss with the regulatory authorities, but we are probably looking at a clinical size study of 110 to 113 or 130 patients. So that's the size we're looking at. So we are on the trajectory to start a phase 2B intercourse study. And this is really, really important for a company like ours, because this will actually enable us, when we go and discuss with partners, not being still in the water. we're actually a company on the trajectory to living the next milestone, the next result on, of the INTERCOURSE study. And I think this is actually giving us a lot of leverage in, the, in our discussions with the pharma partners that we are in dialogue with, and then we will continue the dialogue with. So I think, again, it's really important to say here that the deal with Merck is not taking away the opportunity to go out and continue our business development and work out a deal with a bigger pharma. So what is the position and competitive profile of 2015? Well, as I mentioned earlier, we will be a first-line treatment for the PDC5 non-responders. So we'll target the patients that do not get current relief. We have an oral formulation, so it's a tablet you're going to take. And you can say the only competition we have in the market are injectables, Cavigate and Muse, where you simply inject yourself directly into the penile tissue. And here you get an erection independent of stimulation. So no matter what mood you're in, you can actually still achieve it. We actually strengthen the natural stimulation, and thereby we get what we call, again, a natural erection response. This is a very commercial attractive asset. We have done a pretty safe revenue, peak sales revenue forecasting of $1.5 to $3 billion per year based on the pricing of Cialis and the same consumption per prescription. We also see that it's a potential, you know, off-label use from a lot of the patients that today are using the PDE5 inhibitors, but simply due to the better safety profile. The, you know, a lot of the side effects of the PDE5 are nausea and headaches and so on, and this we have not seen with our compound, and therefore we see a more clean profile here. At last, we can say that the pipeline for new assets for treating these patients are very sparse. So if you look at majority of the compound in is PDE5 inhibitors, new formulations that are acting faster, that will act for a longer time. And again, these are not the patients we are looking to treat. We are looking to treat the non-responders. So we have a very unique positioning here. And our partnering discussions are going really well. We're going forward with all the, even with the MAC deal now and talking with partners, and they're super interested in our compound. They see it's a safe compound that we have demonstrated in the phase 2 and phase 1 trial, and they're actually really intrigued by us using this natural erection response as a potential solution to this problem. So in summary, on the 2015, we have a phase 2 clinical proof of concept to treat non-responders. We have financing in place for conducting a phase 2B study now with this, an INTERCOURSE study. We have a first-in-class drug addressing a significant unmet medical need, and we target a specific population where there's limited competition. So it is only the you can say injectables that are competition. We are not competing with any of the low price products out there. So jumping on to the other program that I've mentioned briefly, the 2018 program. So 2018 is also for erectile dysfunction, but it, however, is for a different kind of erectile dysfunction that we call psychogenic. Psychogenic differs from the organic one that it can actually be younger men getting this. It's not driven so much by lifestyle and also by age. It's actually more driven by other things like stress, depression, anxiety in general, and low self-esteem. And we actually see that this onset is actually can come very suddenly. So it can come one day to another. We will still have the morning erection, so saying that the system is still capable of working when we are free of all these negative impacts on it. And there's a few other things that plays in. I'll get back to that. So we again have a first-class solution with 2018 on solving this issue problem here. So depression and sexual dysfunction and erectile dysfunction in general, we know that depression is a leading cause of a disability and morbid contributor to the overall global burden of disease. In the US alone, it's more than 17 million patients, adult patients, having at least one major depression episode per year. So up to 68% of the people suffering from depression actually also comorbid with sexual dysfunction. This is both true for men and for women. We also know that the antidepressants currently being marketed by majority or all the pharma companies out there actually have a negative impact on the erectile function, ability to achieve orgasms and libido. And also we know that 42% of the men do not adhere to the antidepressants due to intolerable side effects in effectiveness. And one of the things we often hear here is that also because it has the negative sexual dysfunction by taking these tablets. So they simply do not adhere to the treatment, get more depressed, and this is definitely not helping the cycle that I showed you earlier. This is contributing to the psychogenic ED. Of course, you look out in the market, you ask the KOLs, and of, here I just have a few representatives of KOLs in this area. They all see that, you know, depression, sexual dysfunction is a huge problem, and there is no solution to this. So you would need to find something where you can actually both treat the mild depression, and also you're looking at the sexual function. So again, here we're actually targeting something that we heard from the KOLs, that this is important. We heard it from the pharma companies as part of our dialogue on the organic 2015 compound. So you can say that when we started out with 2015 compound, we were set to solve the organic problem. But we actually learned that also in the market, there is a demand for the psychogenic, and this is what we solved with 2018. So looking at 2018, it's very similar to what I showed you before with 2015. It's a triple monoamine reuptake inhibitor. So it still binds to the dopamine, increases the dopamine upon stimulation, and hereby we strengthen the erectile function. Okay, then also it has a component of serotonin. The serotonin inhibitor component is actually what's helping us with the depression component of these patients. So here we say we have a dual effect in the same compound. And this is all due to the profile that this one has a higher affinity for both serotonin and dopamine, whereas the 2015 was majority on the dopamine. So this is a unique compound, and again, we have tested many, many compounds in this series, and we don't see any of these effects in our animal models with other compounds. So we have a very good positioning here. So what is the plan with this? So we have an ongoing phase 2A trial actually at the Mac clinic in the UK. Of course, we also feel the burden and the stress from the COVID-19, but we still believe to be on track for having a readout in mid of 2021. And what we'll do here is we'll actually recruit patients in that have a mild to moderate depressions and suffer from erectile dysfunction between the ages of 18 to 55. It will be a SAD study, a three-way crossover, two dose levels. And then we'll do just like what we did with the 2015 compound. We will stimulate them with an erotic movie, and we will look with the RIT scan on the response here. And this is, we are looking forward to do this. We now have expertise together with MAC running these RIT scan. And this is a really good way to show that we have the sexual or the erection response of the tablets. And we are looking forward to complete this study and moving into the next study, which will be a phase 2B, where you will actually bring it out. You will both look at the depression scores, and you will also look at the erection. So we are on the trajectory to have a psychogenic erectile dysfunction proof of concept mid of 2021. So what's the profile of 2018? Well, again, it's a first oral treatment of psychogenic erectile dysfunction. It's a very commercial attractive asset with blockbuster potential. There's limited competition out there. There is no antidepressant in the market today that improves the sexual function. Many claim that they don't have such bad sexual dysfunction impact on the sexual function. However, we have all antidepressants have a negative one. So what we're looking at here is a unique compound, and that where we are targeting a very unique population. We are targeting the mild to moderate depressed that also have the comorbidity of sexual dysfunction. Also, of course, we also see there's a potential off-label use here for a lot of patients that are maybe not feeling so bad with the current treatment, but again, with a compound that maybe is more mild and will stimulate other things in the sexual function, we believe that this is a good way to bring this compound forward, but we are targeting the mild to moderate depressed patients suffering from erectile dysfunction. So what's happening in Initiator Pharma over the upcoming time? Well, we actually, 20 was a very eventful year for us. We completed the phase 2A trial. We made a rights issue where we actually secured money and oversubscribed to a rights issue, securing money for the clinical trial for the 2018 compound. We have initiated the study. And now we actually saying that we actually also did a deal together with MAC, securing funding, so we don't need to go and get funding for this program. So they're actually going to take up all the clinical cost of running this. And then you can say, what is going to happen in the future? Well, we're going to have the readout of the clinical trial of the 2018 compound mid next year. We're going to have the submission of the 2015 clinical trial application to the authorities in the UK. And also we're going to have the start. So there's a lot of exciting things happening. And of course, all this is combined with the really important part of running a biotech business is the business development. So we are looking to even increase more our interaction now, despite the COVID-19, with potential partners, with potential interested in pharma companies to take these compounds forward in clinical development so we can get them on the market and we also can get either a revenue stream or royalty stream from these compounds. So with this, I would like to take us into the last slide. And that's, again, there's an ongoing exercise of warrants of the TO2 series. And we are looking to bring these into the money so we can get the full exercise, so we can finance the 2018 trial and generate a proof of concept in a very unique indication with a high unmet medical need. And with that, I would like to say thank you very much.
For a good and nice presentation.
Thank you, Lars.
I would like to start to ask you about MAC Clinical Research. What kind of a company or organization is it?
So MAC Clinical Research is an independent CRO. So they conduct clinical trials among a lot of different indications. They have, you can say, one of the things they're looking at is they do a lot of in CNS. They're experts on CNS. They are also expert on, you can say, schizophrenia, they're on pain, they're experts in sexual dysfunction. So there's multiple compounds that they are experts on. And I'm trying to get this picture to be sharp. So it's a really accomplished CRO. They have been doing collaborations with Big Pharma for many years, and this is not new to them. If they believe in a project, they stick their neck out and actually invest in the assets. And I think that this is just showing you that the people that are closest to the compound and who has actually done the most due diligence on this is actually in a position saying that, okay, we believe in this compound, let's take this forward and be part of that upside that is to be picked.
Okay, fine. How important is this funding for the company, and how long will the money last?
Oh, for me, it's a lot more than funding, because it's also an approval that people actually also, it's not only us believing in the quality of 2015, it's actually also the people in the field who has a lot of expertise. No, but bringing in the money is really important, because you can say that by having this, we don't need to go and raise that money in the market. And we actually get a premium of more than 70% to the current share price. So there you can say they are overpaying a little bit to get in to do this. And I think this is just demonstrating again how eager they are to be a part of this. So this is very unique. You bring in right now with the full exercise, we have money in the bank to 2022. And also you can say now with this, we also recently got an Inno Booster grant supporting the 2015 trial of 3.8 million Danish crowns, so 4.5 million Swedish. So that's also helping to our cash positioning. So we are in a good position right now, and we're looking bright in the future.
Sounds great. How big is the overall market for ED?
So ED at the peak sales has sold for about between $4 to $5 billion US dollars a year. And that was you can see that the market is now decreasing because of the generics, so they're getting cheaper compounds coming in. However, we also believe that with our compound, we would actually go in at a pricing, as I mentioned, with the revenue of 1.5 to 2 and 3 billion, depending on the penetration of the market and also depending on the pricing. We believe that the pricing should be fairly comparable to the PD5 products. So it is a big market, and it is an increasing market, not only in Europe, but also very much in Asia, where we see a big increase in the number of patients.
Yeah, what I would like to ask you about. What countries and markets you see the greatest potential? Is that the US or the Asia?
So we know in the US we have around 20 million people getting subscriptions per year for erectile dysfunction. And in Europe, we have about 20 million as well. That number is, we don't have exact numbers for China, because there's a lot of off-label use and a lot of generics that are not registered that they use out there. But just simply by epidemiology, we know that this number is increasing. So if it's not already there, within the next couple of years, it will be just as big as Europe and the US. So we're definitely interested in looking to work out of China as well.
Yes. Would you like to go in a partnership then with Big Pharma?
Yeah, I think that in a biotech company like ours, we would always like to have a partnership with a bigger pharma. But I think it's important that, you know, you can also just try to get a deal for whatever price that is out there. And I think that this is what maybe what we have seen. Some people, they like to do something, but they only want to do it on their terms. And we believe that the asset of 2015 is so valuable that we need to strike a good deal on this. And this is also when we had the opportunity to go with Mac. We said this is better than having to give everything away to a bigger pharma. However, now in the discussion with the bigger pharma, having the leverage of we can actually run the phase 2B trial ourselves, we're actually in a good position for continuing that dialogue. But you can say for the phase 3 and going into the marketing thing, it would be really nice to have a strong partner who has a portfolio that matches the compound. So it's something where it actually we could see that the 2015 compound fits into the strategy of the company. Yes.
Okay. How about the patents in your company?
So the patents. Yes. So on 2015, the patent expires in 31-32. However, we are that's one of the reasons we are working to extend the patent life of these. We have different tricks up our sleeve. I cannot disclose here, of course, what it is, but we actually have a few work on both on formulation and also on dosings that are strengthening the patent position. So we actually could be in a really strong patent position in the future as well. We have a composition of matter patent as until 31 in the US, and this is a good starting point, and then we'll also generate more in the years to come.
Thank you. Do you see any risk using this ED that your company has are going to produce?
Yeah, so when you target the central nervous system, there's always going to be a risk of abuse. And we have early preclinical studies in animal models where we look at what is happening when you give this compound. And there's no liability for misusing these. So what you look at here is the locomotor. How fast do the rats run around? And this is due to the mechanism of action. You can see our compound takes about an hour to reach Cmax, so you don't get this instant boost. So that's taking away some of that. And also, we know most CNS compounds of these families also give a lot of side effects, which is not lethal or anything like that. It's just like nausea and it leads to vomiting. So there's a good safety index on top. And this is actually, you can say that right now our compound looks very safe. We have seen very little in the clinic so far in the dosing of the patients. And so we believe that it is a safe drug that we have developed. And we look forward to bring that into the treatment of erectile dysfunction.
Yes, I have got a question from one of our viewers, and it says, is the deal with the big pharma for IPED 2015 out of the question before the phase 2B study is completed?
No, I think that exactly that's what I'm maybe didn't say explicit enough. I think that having the phase 2B trial is actually a very unique position, because you can say that either a pharma company has to wait until we have completed the trial, or they can actually see that, okay, they actually now doing the trial that we wanted to do to demonstrate this. So here maybe going in and trying to work out an option deal where they're semi-paying for having the right to acquire after the completion, or even doing the ongoing trial. So I think that we are not at this time discarding any of these possibilities, but I think that very much with the MAC deal, we actually are in a unique position to leverage that and use that in the negotiation with partners, maybe to push them a little bit more to be eager, because before they maybe saw that we needed them to help support this, but now they actually know that we're going to complete it, and maybe to avoid the competition of their partners out there, they would like to go in earlier. So that's what we see.
Okay. Well, if soon is going to be Christmas, right? If you would wish, where would the company be in 5 years from now?
Yeah, so I heard that question in the last talk, and 5 years is a long time.
Yeah.
But I think that in 5 years, you know, we actually have demonstrated that the compound, and you know, when I say we, that's either us or together with the partner, or having a compound that is close to being registered for treatment of erectile dysfunction. And actually, and the very unique position here would be that we have a good royalty stream coming in, so we have good revenues from that. And we actually are in the market, not only making money, but we also in a position where we actually treat these patients that do not get current relief. So I think that in 5 years, that's the dream scenario, that the 2015 compound is out there close to registration or already on the market and being launched by a bigger pharma, so it will become worldwide product and to help these 30 to 40% that do not respond to the current treatment. That's the dream scenario. And of course, you can say that the 2015 or the 20 the 2015 compound, the 2018, of course, we hope to follow up with that and do the same and be taking far advanced in the clinic. And maybe even we have additional assets in the pipeline at phase two stages that are in, you know, high unmet medical need conditions. And then we are, of course, looking for having a much more valuable company at that time as well.
Thank you very much, Klaus, for being with us today and for your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.